Hey there, it is your man, the Melon Man. Oh, I wonder if I will ever establish an opening catchphrase. The game I have for you today is a small indie project called In Other Waters. It was developed by one-man studio Jump Over the Age and published by Fellow Traveler in April of 2020. It's a game that I stumbled upon when looking through my humble choice bunch of games, as my burnt-out trashy brain needed a bit of escapism from the lectures that I should have been paying attention to. What can I say? I'm a simple man who can appreciate the dopamine release that comes with a new video game. Not to mention how it looked like something that I could immerse myself into, considering that I was in a headspace that's, not good. This cover art sold me on the game the second I laid my eyes on it. I have a strong fascination with oceans, seas, rivers? Maybe not as much. But lakes? Those freaking slap. I just love watery ecosystems and am intrigued by them to a huge extent. Not to mention how this is what I need right now. I want to just lay back and forget about everything that is taking a toll on me. I'm just gonna go on vacay, jump in the water, baby, get a tan on an alien world. Will I rot if that happens? So here is this chill-looking, somewhat simplistic indie game about exploring the alien oceanic landscapes of Gliese 667cc, and my mind is already racing with images of beautiful environments that are going to be showcased during this short trip. Yes, this is an odd one. In terms of genre labels that I'm gonna tie to this game's ankles as a means to pull it down to the ocean floor like cement shoes do, I'm gonna simply call this one a visual novel. But if I can express myself in a more detailed manner, it's an exploration-based visual novel with light survival elements, sporting a really clean and stripped-back visual department. Also coupled with an engaging lore and story. It's kinda unusual and experimental in terms of the genres it's trying to fuse together, and it really ends up feeling special, and I'm going to show you why. In Other Waters puts you in the not-so-hypothetical but also digital shoes of an AI suit that's utilized by stranded xenobiologist Ellery Voss, who was called to Gliese by fellow scientist Mine Nomura. The game opens with a corrupted log file in which someone called AN was trying to hide you, along with their apparent discoveries, naming you Oki in the process. What these apparent discoveries are, however, you are unable to tell due to how you seem to have suffered some sort of memory corruption. Upon trying to locate Mine, Ellery stumbles upon you and asks for your help. It's also clear from the get-go that this AN character knows Mine somehow, but there isn't much data to work with yet. Let's just focus on helping Ellery with piecing together the puzzle and figuring out what scientific discoveries could have been made on this so-called unremarkable planet. After a short introductory boot-up sequence, you're free to explore and move around in the vast ocean of Gliese.
Alright dude, that's not cool. Who asked my girlfriend about our sex life?
You slowly but surely start to move around, and...
Like, okay Melon, this is like, what is happening here? What's that little thing? Is that like a Minecraft squidderino that's spazzing through the watery landscape of this 2D alien establishment? Like, what is going on here? What are those icons, the yellow dots and all that?
Let me explain. The visual novel tag on my behalf was included for a reason. This game won't show you the immaculate detail of the oceanic wildlife of the planet. The aforementioned log states that you were put through some kind of restrictions, explaining away your limited vision and UI. Essentially, you only have a small scanner at your disposal, which you can use to scan the environment surrounding you for potential signs of life or just landmarks. Based on the information you gathered, Ellery will observe the landmark or life form you're looking at and give you a rundown on it, collecting data in the process. Landmarks serve as waypoints between which you can move around. It feels restrictive to navigate your surroundings in such a stiff and controlled way in a setting like this one. But the mechanic actually favors the atmosphere, as you're only capable of seeing the small tidbits of the world at a time, which in turn makes everything seem bigger and more mysterious. Certain landmarks also serve as sampling locations where you can gather samples of the reefs that surround you. And this is when In Other Waters clicks into place in a way. There is a working ecosystem that you and Ellery will gradually figure out while strutting around, occasionally letting the acquired little beans back in the water. Certain samples have an effect on your environment. The flora of Gliese is alive in ways you would not think, closing paths behind you or just offering you different obstacles to circumnavigate. And as you're slowly getting to know how all of this works, you'll realize how samples are able to manipulate the behavior of both fauna and flora, opening up closed up paths or slowing down fast flowing currents by growing or retracting reefs. But before you start running, you gotta learn how to, walk. Swim? Walk, I guess, but like, underwater, like the failed Jesus wannabe that you are. To move around, you have to scout for landmarks. You look at one you just found and use the movement tool, point in its direction, and off you go. Before you could move on, you'll have to manually scan with the designated button and look for new landmarks or sampling locations to visit. This renders the game to be pretty slow, as each new waypoint you discover is accompanied by a detailed description by Ellery, not to mention how she's also talking to you while moving about. This isn't a criticism though, as I really enjoy the pace the game dictates throughout. I gotta say, at first I was actually kinda overwhelmed as I was casually scanning everything around me, receiving tons of text while Ellery was asking for my input on certain matters, and I ended up feeling terribly anxious as it felt like the upcoming exam I was prepping for. I could see the tremendous amount of information scrolling in front of me, and hear the disappointed sighs as I was incapable of fulfilling my role in education. What am I even doing at this point? Then I suddenly got scared when something screeched on the radar and I remembered that I'm playing this video game. Aside from your own, existential dread and demons, there aren't many dangers to avoid. You have two gauges, power and an oxygen meter respectively. Power slowly decreases whenever you move between waypoints and will be utilized by a tool later on. Oxygen is required for using a propulsion system. It is also drained by having to use your rebreather when wandering through toxic flora. Here comes the question you're probably kinda curious about. How does this visual novel utilize these mechanics? Quite well. At first, it's just the casual act of not getting lost between a million landmarks and observing your surroundings. Then it becomes a bit more complicated in environments which pose some sort of threat in the form of constantly decreasing oxygen or power bars. These can only be filled up with the use of samples you find out in the wild. So with that out of the way, let's talk sampling. You have a little claw machine type deal going on, which lets you pick up samples in specific locations. These are going to keep you alive, but also serve as the foundation for your research. In the beginning of your journey, you will stumble upon something called a way station, which is basically a checkpoint where you and Ellery can refuel and download map data of the region you're currently in. If you're in a mapped out region, you can ask for extraction via drone to return to a base of operation of sorts. Here, Ellery and you can have a few short convos while chilling and conducting research, which is one of the main mechanics of the game. Every sample you collected can be dragged into and analyzed in the lab portion of the base. The system then gives you a bunch of details and Ellery's thoughts about the species and the taxonomy, so you can learn about all the intricacies of Gliese's wildlife. No, it's not about economy or taxes or shit, like, get out of here. And while all this is fine and dandy, I can't help but feel like the game has a few shortcomings that are worth talking about. The only thing that comes to my mind really is the tedium of it that can settle in rather early on. Because again, controlling the suit is not all that engaging if you're using the mouse. Yeah, the game can be played with either a controller or a mouse with additional keyboard shortcuts. The controller has dedicated buttons for selecting specific suit functionalities, keyboard controls are not that extensive, and the bulk of the work is gonna be done with the mouse. Essentially, you're clicking on everything or dragging things around, and I wish the control scheme utilized the keyboard the same way it did the controller. And in my humble opinion, the good old weapon of many a nerd would only need a few shortcuts. I guess it would feel a bit smoother, though I understand the slow, methodical approach the developers intended when it comes to traversing the environment. But this, in my head, which is a dangerous and uncharted new world, would make for a smoother control scheme. I have no other complaints really. And these are just some nitpicks that I could think of from the top of my head. Maybe one more thing. Sometimes the game asks you to tread through hostile environments with decreasing oxygen or power gauges, and I feel like writing longer descriptions for waypoints in places like that is kinda counterintuitive. I usually get a bit worried about my supplies and how I won't be able to get out of there if I start reading these, but really, that's all the concerns that I can think of right now. If this wasn't apparent up until this point, you'll have to read a lot in this game to understand what's happening. Research endeavors especially offer a variety of insight on the planet's ecosystem. This is the point where you might get turned off if reading and exploration that's reliant on using your imagination is not something you enjoy. The game utilizes a toolset that's limited in terms of visuals. filling out most of its world with writing. It is intentional and well done, to the point where I became deeply immersed and was reading and visualizing everything the game threw my way. Having not been there myself, I can only imagine the amber reefs as they dance in the sunlight, with reef scrapers speeding by them. Or the toxic microbial wastelands in which only the toughest of survivors can persevere. But these are all experiences that are more akin to reading a book than playing a video game. For me, In Other Waters emulates the oddly specific vibe of stumbling upon an old piece of science fiction, either in your attic or in an antique bookstore. You don't know what you just found, and upon diving headfirst, you just get lost in a beautiful and untouched world that's only available to you in a way. It feels special and personal, and Ellery's description of the environment is detailed, sometimes even poetically beautiful. The writing is definitely one of the strongest aspects of In Other Waters, but it's focused on biology. Again, you're going to observe alien vegetation and wildlife, based on which you'll end up with detailed descriptions of a specific species, its looks, behavior, theories on why they are the way they are, and even some sketches on what they look like. It's clear that the developer and main writer behind the project, Mr. Gareth Damian Martin, is knowledgeable about this stuff. The intricacies in how nature operates on Gliese are so detailed and vividly described. Throughout your playthrough, you'll learn about the symbiotic relationships of flora and fauna, for example, and how they utilize each other to spread. It's vivid, it's rich in detail and extensively thought out, it is impeccable actually. Unfortunately, you're not going to be able to look at scary fish in a general sense, but there is a lot to see and read. The game's UI is what you're going to look at for the most part. It is clean, straightforward, and easy to navigate. The overabundance of buttons at first can look a bit intimidating, but figuring out what does what literally takes like 5 minutes. Again, it's a game that intentionally narrows what you can see to offer a more visual novel-esque experience. You're literally reading a digital book, bucko. Everything is an interface, or a text box, but a readable and compact one at that. You can even increase the size of it if you'd like, which I'm a fan of as an idiot with a broken pair of glasses. The stripped-back visual department results in the obvious. Vegetation and wildlife are merely dots and icons, but the blue-yellow color scheme works in beautiful contrast, with the blues becoming darker to indicate a change in depth. Graphically, as you can see, there isn't all that much to dissect in this one. But undoubtedly, it's not the visuals that will immerse you in this one, but the writing and the music. Oh boy, the music. The music and sound design of In Other Waters was composed by Amos Roddy, who made a few soundtracks before. Unfortunately, I haven't heard any of them yet. One thing's for sure, Mr. Roddy understands what makes a game score atmospheric. His synth work sounds detuned and distant without sounding dissonant, which he accomplished with these wailing, occasionally distorted melodies that vibrate and jitter, almost like something huge has been moving around deep below but you can't just see it because it's obscured by darkness and is really far away. There is a clear sense of mystery in his compositions because of how these detuned melodies meet the bubbling ocean. Some of the cuts on this album are hopeful and busy. Pillar Gardens comes to mind, which is one of my favorites. It starts out with a jazz-inspired instrumental that slowly fades out, giving enough breathing room for atmospheric synth pads to envelop the mix. Drifting Lands is one of my favorites as well. It is actually the music you hear on the bass. It consists of this quiet, somber melody that is in harmony with the aforementioned synth work, which quietly dances around in the background, serving as an added layer of depth, painting the scene for an underwater researched base where you might actually be able to hear all this outside. The instrumental gets a tad bit busier with melancholic synth leads, making the song feel lonely and gloomy, but at the same time it's full of hope and wonder. Thank you. The reverb-y, deep sound of it, coupled with the distant-sounding instruments, literally made me feel like I'm physically submerged. Not like in a shoegaze manner where you're bathing in sound, but like, I'm in the water. I am the water.
We are water.
A wide array of emotions have been captured with this soundtrack. Honestly, it was tailor-made for this game. It's so good, in fact, that I need a cassette or a vinyl release as soon as possible because I need to own this in physical form. I feel like my love towards the ocean has me in a state where I'm just deeply immersed and captivated by music that displays its qualities in such a beautiful manner. I love this soundtrack. I'm biased and sad. 10 out of 10. However, Roddy also pulled a Trent Reznor, as he's responsible for the entire sound design of the game. The sound of water running by me as I'm wading through currents and the curious scared little noises uttered by creatures that I somehow came to disturb in their natural habitats. It's all deeply immersive. Also, that's like one more thing I messed up. Poor little guys. Sorry, reef scrapers. I love the suffocating, deep bassiness of the ocean floor and just the ambience in general. The UI sounds are really crisp and futuristic sounding, and scanning my way through the ocean sounds and feels pretty nice, especially when I'm beeping around a place where I'm not supposed to be. But what kind of places are we talking here? What is this game about besides cataloging all wildlife on a planet that's uninhabited? In Other Waters is a story about many things, actually. It's a story about loss, about human nature, about nature itself, and also relationships to some extent. Ellery's journey towards finding Mine is a weird one. Submerged under the ocean, she's looking for someone who she trusts and loves. A friend. A colleague. They both work for a company called Baikal, and have a history together. However, they seem to have separated after a falling out they had on another planet. This is where our story picks up when Mine asks Ellery to investigate Gliese 667cc. The beginning few hours are spent looking for Mine and the clues she left, the way stations she established, and during all this you will slowly learn about Ellery's relationship with her, and you yourself will get invested and tangled up in the threads of the narrative. The story starts out relatively slow, and you're going to be more focused on learning about the environment at first, trying to piece together what Mine's intentions were when it comes to researching this place. All our clues lead to something called the Bloom, which is located deeper in the ocean. Getting there, however, will require better equipment in the form of a propulsion drive that enables us to wade through stronger currents. Upon finding some of Mine's broken equipment and fixing up the drive, the Bloom opens up to us in its destructive and vivid glory. An unnatural, harsh underwater world of toxic microbes that destroy and devour. It feels almost unreal that a place like this could exist in the colorful, peaceful ocean world of Gliese in such a compact way, separated from the rest of it, housing only the toughest creatures capable of surviving. It feels like it doesn't belong, not to mention how the vague notion of the flora and fauna being sick due to something unknown lingers on since the beginning, as Ellery just can't wrap her head around the whole deal, as some of the vegetation just seems to be reacting to something spontaneous and abnormal. As a character, I find her beautifully compelling, even though I don't have a hint about what she looks or sounds like. Your journey together is truly a bonding experience as you have back and forths about possible theories regarding what's happening to the environment. She feels believable and real as she struggles to understand her circumstances and is driven by a strong sense of curiosity to dive deeper and deeper to find her friend. The rest, however, is spoiler territory. If you'd like to explore the game's world and story yourself, then skip to this part, where I'll give you my spoiler-free summary of Another Waters' story. The rest of you should put on a helmet or something, cause we're taking a digital bath, baby.
I feel like a ball.
Gotta stop with the references.
Upon descending into the depths of Gliese's oceans, you'll find out that, in fact, you're not the first humans to visit the planet. There isn't a piece of evidence to better showcase this than the crashed Baikal spaceship down on the ocean floor, among toxic pools that are described as brine lakes. Well, maybe there is a better one. The Arcology. A giant underwater city housing Baikal personnel. Well, there used to be people here. They're dead now. The logs of the dead suggest that whatever went down must have happened in an instant, and the company deemed it best to pull the plug. This is where Ellery starts airing the dirty laundry of Baikal. a company focused on furthering humanity's attempts at expanding, the necessity of which is due to how in this universe, we done fucked up and Earth suffered the consequences. Its oceans, dead, and its atmosphere gray of all the abuse. And Ellery has seen it all firsthand. Everyone who gets a chance tries to leave it behind to find a new habitable home. In this process, what Baikal does is essentially taking advantage of uninhabited worlds, mining their resources and just using them to further the wasteful and expansionist attempts of ours. It's a bleak view on humanity and human nature that seems oddly fitting right now, which in my eyes renders it to be a strong and effective critique of what the actual fuck we're doing. It doesn't stop there, however. Baikal seemed to have discovered a species on Gliese. A species that is made up of natural quantum computers, and is capable of affecting the environment surrounding them, essentially guiding evolution through rewriting DNA and RNA in themselves and in other creatures, let it be flora or fauna. Hence they are called artificers. Artificers? Artificers? These kind of archaic words, and the American accent I learned is kind of, they occasionally have this collision, I apologize. Hence they are called artificers. The aforementioned qualities have intrigued Baikal enough, which resulted in them trying to mimic what the artificers were capable of by creating microbes to terraform Gliese. However, due to a catastrophe, the microbes escaped the factory and dominated the entirety of the planet, bringing on the extinction of the artificers and creating a planet-wide toxic bloom. Except that the artificers' bodies, even after dying, were capable of containing the bloom microbes, restricting it to one section of the planet. They forced nature in mere decades to adapt to immensely toxic new circumstances, even in their deaths. After digging up most of what remains of Baikal's files, something called the Oceanic Mind came up. A giant entity based on the artificers that would dictate evolution on the planet in a more controlled and effective way than the microbes. They also tried to utilize artificer tech by creating AI based on it. One such project was you, Oki. You were created by Mine's mother in the arcology before the microbes got out and ruined everything. Therefore, the crash and message you received in the beginning was logged during the catastrophe and you were sent out to find Mine and tell her, but it was probably too late. She herself, however, ends up in a rather interesting situation, as her body and DNA have been changed by the artificer bodies in the water, keeping her alive without her suit in the deep, but also gradually turning her into something else as a means to make sure she survives in the environment. Considering how Ellery and her had a troubled and long history, and were even romantically involved, this process comes with a relatively small amount of pain, and simple acceptance as Ellery understands why she had to come here and how Mine has given her a chance to right Baikal's wrongs and air their dirty laundry, basically for everyone else to see. You and her visit the Oceanic Mine, but what's left of it is a carcass, a monolithic corpse. On the inside, however, there is hope. A living artificer, scared of the human they just encountered. Rightfully so after mankind has inadvertently caused their extinction through carelessness. Ellery's purpose is clear. She thanks you for helping her through this journey and decides to stay so she can try and fix what has happened to Gliese. While also asking you to send the final kick in the nuts for Baikal by sending out every collected data to freely spread in the galaxy about the company's shady dealings. A story about big corporation doing something dumb is not new. We all know about Weyland-Yutani, Umbrella, and all the other dinguses really. But I feel like the effectiveness of In Other Waters' story comes from how it utilizes this trope and sets it in the bleakest possible continuation of how our current endeavors on this planet are shaping up to be. It showcases human nature at its worst, where nothing is sacred when it comes to our wealth, and how ruining the only habitable planet doesn't stop certain individuals from trying to attain said wealth. It's a bleak story that also hints at how we are disconnected from nature. Yet again, kind of a narrative thread that has been explored by many in a way. But instead of basing it on the dichotomy of technology and nature, it's the lack of nature due to careless and methodical destruction, compared to finding the beauty of it in a world that, at least on the surface, hasn't been exposed to our fuckery just yet. I myself spend a lot of time connecting with nature nowadays. In my own way, alone, wandering forests and trying to find who I am. How could I be the best possible version of myself? What makes me? Why am I the way I am? And just like that, I felt like In Other Waters had that sense of someone who never found something or lost something substantial to their personality and then rediscovers it yet again or finds it for the first time, connecting with something ancient and much bigger in the process. Much, much bigger. Hey, thanks for being patient. We're back now. To sum it up, In Other Waters' story is a tragic tale with a strong personal journey vibe. It's also a beautiful roller coaster through an environment that's unlike anything else out there. I really enjoyed reading my way through the game's world and getting to know Ellery in the process. It's not an optimistic take on sci-fi, it is a bit bleak sometimes, but there's always hope or a sense of purpose to whatever you're doing. It's a masterfully written, beautiful work of fiction that is more relevant than you would expect, especially in a world and time period where AAA video games are so utterly horrified and afraid of having a meaningful critical perspective on anything, even on fucking climate change. Again, indies are doing the heavy lifting. It is worth your time if you're looking for a personal adventure in a brave new world that is also intricate and well thought out with an outstanding character, and I think that's all I wanted to say. In conclusion, In Other Waters is an experimental visual novel that utilizes an engaging sci-fi setting to tell a story of self-discovery and discovery, and it's definitely something that you should experience if you like visual novels or any sort of science fiction, and you're also not afraid of reading a lot. Or using your imagination. Its visuals are wonderfully simple and straight to the point. The music and sound design are wonderfully woven into the fabric of the story, adding an immensely immersive layer to it. While I do think that the gameplay side of things can get a bit tedious by the end, the story captivated me enough to keep on sampling and surviving in the depths of the ocean. I can wholeheartedly recommend this one. If you have Humble Choice going, you probably already have it. You should play it if that's the case, because it'd be good. The dev is also working on a new game called Project Sidereal, so I'm already intrigued. Especially if it comes with another Amos Roddy soundtrack, please. So, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed my content, please check out my other stuff. Subscribe. Whoopity 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 ass of that stinky bell and like or dislike the video according to how you feel about it, I guess. Prey video is cursed, it's gonna be done one day. Also, the channel is going to have its 1 year anniversary on the 26th. And there are already more than 600 of you here, so I would like to thank you for sticking around and sabotaging my attempts of leaving all this behind whenever I'm feeling down. Jokes aside, I deeply appreciate that. Thank you again, I should call you something, dear viewers. That way, I can finally feel like I belong to the upper echelon of tuber content maker people, while also showcasing a frail notion of, ooh, quirky personality to become more engaging and colorful in the eyes of yours. Thank you again, my super seedy, sad seedling guy. Like, is this like enough layers of irony? I don't think so.
Forest G for life.
See ya.